Okay, well, welcome back, everyone. We have here Marie Harf, who is a deputy spokesperson for the U.S. Department of State. We will now turn to the segment of the program where we just basically have a discussion with Marie about her career path as well as her role as deputy spokesperson. But a little bit of background about Marie. She was appointed as deputy spokesperson in June 2013. In this role, she serves as an advisor to Secretary of State and other senior officials on communication strategy. Ms. Harf and the deputy spokesperson are responsible for daily press briefings, and she also travels overseas with senior State Department officials. Prior to joining the State Department, Ms. Harf served as a senior advisor to and press spokesperson for Chuck Hagel during his confirmation to be Secretary of Defense. Ms. Harf was the Central Intelligence Agency's media spokesperson, where she crafted the CIA's media strategy on a wide range of sensitive national security and intelligence topics. Ms. Harf also has experience working on a presidential campaign, joining President Obama's re-election campaign in 2012. And during the election, Ms. Harf was responsible for all national security and foreign policy issues on President Barack Obama's campaign. She also developed and implemented the campaign's national security policy and communication strategy and served as a press spokesperson on national security issues. She was also a member of President Obama's debate preparation team for the town hall and foreign policy debates. Ms. Harf began her federal government career in the CIA's Directorate of Intelligence, where she was an analyst on Middle East leadership issues. She produced finished intelligence products, including items for the president's daily brief, on top foreign policy priorities, providing insight and context while identifying risks and opportunities for the United States. Ms. Harf graduated from Indiana University, earning a bachelor's degree in political science with concentrations in Jewish studies and Russian and Eastern European studies. She also received her master's degree from the University of Virginia in foreign affairs, where her thesis evaluated the prospects for continued regime stability in Saudi Arabia. So I would say that Marie has been quite busy following her graduate and undergraduate career, both inside and outside of government. And Marie, many thanks for sitting with us today. I think that not only do you have one of the most challenging jobs in the administration, but I would think that you have a very diverse career trajectory, which prepared you for the job that you have today. So with that, I just want to sort of give folks kind of an idea of how you even started in this business and how you got interested and pursued this career. Mm-hmm. So if you just want to give a little bit of background about that.
Of course, yes. And thank you so much for having me, especially with the weather. I know it's crazy right now. So thank you all for coming today, and we're happy to have you with us. I think two really key things sort of got me to where I am today. The first is when I was in college, and this is going to date me a bit, I was a junior when September 11th happened in 2001. And so for me, until that point, I sort of knew I was interested in foreign policy. I thought maybe Russia. But that was really a catalyzing event for me where I thought, okay, this is this life-changing thing that's happened. All of my friends and I sort of at that point figured out, how do we want to help? And how do we want to make a difference? And how can we participate in some way in what we knew was coming? Not everyone will have sort of one of those big moments, historical moments happen when they're in college, thankfully, when it comes to that. But I think all of us have a moment where you think, okay, I want to do this, and this is interesting, and maybe I can help, and I'm good at something that maybe could be helpful here. So that's when I started studying political science specifically, and that's when I knew I wanted to come to Washington and do something for the federal government. I wasn't sure what. And then I did an internship for the State Department, actually, after undergraduate at the U.S. mission to the U.N., and I met a lot of great State Department people there, a lot of people from other agencies, and that sort of reinforced for me that I wanted to do something for the federal government. And then I went back to graduate school and applied for one job, which was at the CIA. So thankfully, I got it. I think my parents were a little nervous. But I thought that my skills would be helpful in doing that. And this was an analyst job. This was not a press job. So I did that for 3 years, and then a press job opened up. I had never done press. I had no training and no experience, but I thought, okay, this seems really interesting. I have some skills I think could make me good at it. And I'm going to give it a shot. And I'm going to try. And what's the worst that can happen? I go do something else. So that was the end of 2008 when I started doing press, which I've done pretty continuously ever since. But I didn't know in college that I would end up doing this. And so that was interesting. And then another big turning point was leaving federal government. I had a civil service job at the CIA, which meant
you know, it's job stability. You pretty much can't get fired unless, you know, you leak classified information or something. That's not entirely true, but it's a really stable career. That's not entirely true for everyone on YouTube that's going to see this. It's a very stable, it's a stable career. And going to join a presidential campaign is a leap of faith, right, in the future. And win, lose, or draw, you're out of a job at the end of it. Now, if you win, hopefully you will get one. If you lose, hopefully you will get one, too. I remember my dad saying to me, are you going to have health insurance? Like, this is, you know, what he was worried about. But regardless of party or partisanship, I think presidential campaign or any campaign is really a life-changing experience. If you care about something, fight for it. I think that's sort of a basic tenet of what we all do here. Mm-hmm. And stand up and tell people why you're fighting for it and why you think they should, too. That's a pretty powerful thing. It's better when you win, I will say. And then after that, I ended up here doing press. But, it all sounds, when Karen was reading it, it sounds so linear and like it all just makes sense. But it doesn't when you're living it. I can say that. And after, you know, we won a presidential campaign, and for 4 months after that, I was unemployed, which people are at the end of a campaign, but it's a scary thing, and it's unknown, and you've just done this amazing thing, and you're trying to figure out what comes next, and you don't know, and that's a hard thing. So, I don't know. That's how I got where I am today.
I think that one of the things that we're seeing and is that having our audience and our participants like hear from Foreign Service officers and people who work here mm-hmm. is that no person has one linear mm-hmm. path here. Like, we all have diverse sort of career trajectories. Some people took the Foreign Service exam. Other folks went into the civil service, just sort of applied. Other people got into it via political campaigns. So I think that one of the main things mm-hmm. that we want to stress to a lot of people who are interested in international affairs, foreign affairs careers, is that, as Marie mentioned, mm-hmm. is that really not, it's a very circuitous sort of process. A lot of people, you know, for the sake of like the bio, like it reads, you know, the bio that it actually reads like it is linear, but you'll find that with so many people and their lives and their career trajectories, that it's a lot more varied than sort of like, than just, oh, I went to school and I got my med degree and then I became a doctor, et cetera. So that was a very good point. And just to sort of give also our audience kind of an idea of what your job entails, because mm-hmm. even just reading the bio, I don't think it fully captures like all of what entails like a day's work in the life of Marie Harf and Jen Psaki, the faces of the State Department. Yeah. So, yeah.
No, it's a good question. And I, you know, Jen Psaki, my counterpart, she's the other one who does daily press briefings. If you've seen them, she has very cool red hair. She's very distinct and wonderful. And she's going back to the White House soon, which I know we're all very sad about. But every single day at the State Department, we hold a daily press briefing. At the podium, in the briefing room, I just got done doing it. We are the only government agency in D.C. that does. When the secretary travels, we still do a briefing. The White House actually doesn't. When the president travels, they tend to do a off-camera on the plane or wherever they are. So every single day, we are forced to stand up and say to the world why we're doing what we're doing and answer questions. That drives a huge part of the day. I do that briefing when Jen is traveling with the secretary, which is where she is now. She does it when I'm traveling. We always have a spokesperson with Secretary Kerry because he has a lot of press issues. So she's with him right now. I'll leave on a trip with him next week. But then beyond that, you know, we all both know this. Really, there are all these issues the State Department talks about. I know, I think you heard about climate change today. That's a huge issue that's not always in the news, but we spend a lot of time thinking strategically about how we can advance our public narrative on these issues. And that's hard sometimes, right? Because the day-to-day is taken up by breaking news. I just spent an hour in the briefing room talking about Secretary Clinton's emails and our ambassador in South Korea. That doesn't leave a lot of time to think about like the broader changes in the world and what we can do to help, but we have to force ourselves to. So a lot of it is meeting with other department officials, helping get them ready for interviews, just figuring out in this huge building what our message is on a whole host of issues and how we get that out, whether it's the daily briefing, whether it's cable TV, whether it's other ways, whether it's blog posts or Twitter Q&As. It's just sort of keeping this communications ship moving forward and trying to do what we need to do every day.
So when you're moving at such a fast pace, and I don't know how many of you have seen Marie at the podium, but she could be asked a question on Turkey, she could be asked a question on emails, on Clinton emails, she can be asked on a whole host mm-hmm. of issues that are like in and of themselves, like they are very complex issues. Mm-hmm. What do you do to prepare yourself? Because, you know, just as a sort of a person just sort of watching, mm-hmm. it's just like, it's actually quite amazing to see you guys go from one issue to the next.
Yeah.
And literally, and the State Department has experts on these issues. The White House National Security Staff, National Security Council now, has a staff that deals specifically on Africa, specifically on climate change, specifically on the Middle East. And here Marie has to, you know, field all of these questions. So what goes into your preparation for that?
Yeah, we do. We cover the world. And we're very lucky here that we have a lot of smart policy experts who follow these issues very closely. So for about 2 hours before I brief every day, people who cover the world, basically, we're divided into bureaus, which I'm sure you've heard about today, but each bureau will come brief me, and they'll say, this is what's happening in our area of the world, this is what you should say on it, and that means if I get asked a question about something that's only coming up in the local Japanese press, I know what to say, which is very helpful. But then also there's these bigger issues, right? On Secretary Clinton's emails today, I go into each briefing on big issues like that. There are facts, but it's really about tone and how you want to handle it mm-hmm. and what you want to accomplish. And I go in every day with two or three goals. No matter what I get asked, I need to say these two or three things because I want them on the record. But it's also whether you want to be combative, whether you want to be laid back, whether you want to be calm, whether you want to be argumentative. These are tonal things that you think about every day. And it is drinking from a fire hose. And the thing I've learned from that is you should say when you don't know something. It actually gives you more credibility. My instinct is to always want to know the answer and to say something really smart. And sometimes I don't know the answer. You shouldn't make it up, certainly. But you also there's power in saying, you know what, I don't know. But I'll ask and I'll find out. It's just honest. And I think actually gives you more credibility. And so at the briefings, there's times I just say, I actually don't know the answer to your question, but it's a really interesting one, even if sometimes it's not really interesting.
Well, and speaking of a presidential campaign, which is very different, I would think, than sort of working inside government. So what are the differences in how did working on a presidential campaign mm-hmm. Prepare you for what you're doing?
Yeah. Now? Well, it's funny. In today's briefing, I actually made a joke about how I'm lucky now that I get to only worry about elections that happen overseas. Presidential campaigns, there's nothing more fast moving than a presidential campaign on a daily basis, particularly in the last few months. Mm-hmm. There's breaking news here. There's nights you don't sleep a lot. But at the end of a presidential campaign, it is full speed. You don't sleep very much because there's a deadline and you know you're up against it. I think for me, an interesting thing too is I'm a foreign policy nerd, right? I'm really interested in domestic policy, but I've never worked in it. But on a presidential campaign, even though I did national security, I got to pay attention to all the other issues we were talking about, whether it was equal pay or health care or all of these other domestic issues, immigration, right, that I don't deal with in my job, but I'm interested in them. And you feel like you're a part of something that's working on those issues, and that is very cool. And the third thing I would say is, in our jobs in D.C., it is very easy to forget what the rest of America thinks. In a presidential campaign, even at a presidential level, you actually get to go talk to real Americans and say, on foreign policy, you know, what do you think about America's place in the world? And what do you think about how the president's doing? And let me talk to you about that. That is amazing. And I'm from the Midwest. I'm from Ohio. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, I miss that outside the Beltway. Sort of getting real sense for what people are thinking out there. And that's really powerful. That's why we're all here, right? Representing people in our country. So I think that's very powerful. And then I will stop talking. I just got done doing a briefing. I'm kind of in briefing mode.
No, please.
I'm just going to talk forever. But I do think that there are certain skills, whether you're a CIA analyst or a spokesperson or do something totally different, that presidential campaigns help with, but that you should just try and develop, right? Whether it's being able to write well very quickly. Speed is really something on a presidential campaign that you have to have. And that helps you as you go on to different jobs in life, even ones that aren't as crazy as a presidential campaign. And the ability to be very clear and very concise and very succinct, whether writing or briefing someone quickly, you have to be quick. And that, I think, is the biggest thing I probably learned.
Great. And I think that, you know, before, because we also want to make sure to take some questions from you all. And so just for the second part of that session, you see the two standing mics right there on the other side of the aisles. If you want to make sure you line up there for the questions, that would be great. But I just want to turn a little bit towards some of the issues per se that you have to speak about every day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think that, you know, just looking through the newspapers, watching the news, there's a lot going on in the world. And so what do you think our most challenging foreign policy issues are that we face today? And where mm-hmm. does, for example, like countering violent extremism
yeah.
and combating ISIL fall into this list?
It's a really good question. I've thought a lot about this. I think if you look at the Middle East right now, not just ISIL, mm-hmm. but a lot of that's ISIL. It's Syria, it's Iraq, it's Libya, which I would put in the Middle East, it's Yemen. It's as unstable as we've seen, I think, certainly since we've been in office probably, and there's a variety of reasons for that, but it's concerning. If you look across the region, there are a lot of really complicated problems and not a lot of easy answers, mm-hmm. not any easy answers, I would say. So that, I think, is a place where, you know, if you look back at the Arab Spring, the region went through all of these generational. When you're getting rid of dictators who've been there for decades, it stirs up all this generational change that plays out in ways that we're just starting to understand. And that is a really complicated process that we're seeing play out in a place like Libya. It's really, there are some tough challenges there, and they're going to be with us for a while. We're obviously very focused on Iran. I'm sure you've all heard about this and the nuclear negotiations. We're pushing up against a deadline here to see if we can get this done. That's certainly concerning. I think Russia and Russian aggression is something that, you know, my dad was a professor at Ohio State. He was a Soviet specialist, and it was sort of something I grew up with, and then we all thought was changing. But now this is, when you have a permanent member of the Security Council sending tanks and troops into a neighboring country, that's pretty extraordinary when you think about it. That's pretty aggressive. And I think we're not sure how this is going to end. I think this is a long-term fight, too. And then I'll say two more quick things. One is the notion of violent extremism that Karen brought up is a good one to mention, because in today's world, I always say the internet's a blessing and a curse. I mean, you don't have to go to Afghanistan or Somalia to get trained anymore to be a terrorist. You can go on the internet, watch a bunch of videos, go make a bomb at home and go attack, you know, your local whatever, school, shopping mall. I don't want to scare people, but so I'll be more upbeat in a second. But the notion that extremism can travel the world in seconds and make this hateful rhetoric and ideas available to people that haven't seen it, wouldn't have seen it before, is really, it's a concerning threat. And how you challenge that is something we're thinking a lot about. But again, there are no easy answers here. And then something I already mentioned, but there's these bigger term issues, these longer term issues. Climate change, we wouldn't say is a long term issue, but where it's really hard to focus on that, you know, in the course of a given week when the world is on fire. Things like, you know, we're doing our International Women of Courage ceremony here tonight. Things like women's education. These are incredibly important things. These change lives and communities and countries. And climate change has the ability to really negatively impact all those things. It's hard to focus on that in the press of business every day, but we have to, right? And that's hard.
Yeah, I mean,
the world is not as terrible as I make it sound, though, I promise.
Well, which leads to my next question. So, you know, I think that, you know, it's easy to focus on the negative, particularly
yes,
if
I
what
agree.
You're bombarded with
yes.
every day is what's happening and going wrong in the world. And I think that, mm-hmm. you know, the president is very optimistic about
yes.
the challenges that we face globally here in this country. So do you feel optimistic about, you know, the ways that things are going, and also public diplomacy, and we've talked about it a little bit today, is a huge mm-hmm. part of this. So
yeah.
which ways have you seen it work successfully and maybe in some cases unsuccessfully?
Yeah.
And yeah, so.
I know I named a bunch of really awful things
and
I didn't mean to, but if you look, and the Secretary Kerry's made this point publicly, if you look around the world, fewer people around the world are dying because of disease today. Fewer people around the world are dying today than they ever have because of massive land wars. There are things we have dealt with as a world in the past decades And we have different challenges now, but we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that we have tackled problems before and we can do it again. Mm-hmm. And I do agree, I'm a naturally optimistic person. Yeah. And President Obama is, if you look at a lot of our, so we have all these great programs. One is our young African leaders and one is our young Asian leaders, where we are, the State Department and the U.S. government is creating these networks of young leaders in countries throughout Africa and throughout parts of Asia that can learn all these skills and teach us skills and then stay in there, go back to their countries and change their countries and be the next leaders. That's all about the future, right? That's about how you have places that may have terrible governance now, but if you train leaders to do better, maybe in 10 or 20 or 50 years, you won't. And that's how you change these things. It's not overnight. And so all of those things, you know, I think I am optimistic. I think there are tough challenges, though. And look, I mean, I think, you know, our predecessors in these jobs, I mean, can you imagine being in this job during World War II? When, I mean, seriously, think about it, right? The world must have appeared awful, and it was awful then. Yeah. But we dealt with that together, and we got through it, right? Now we have different challenges, but we've dealt with this kind of stuff before. We have tools to do that, right?
Yeah, and I think part of the challenge, too, is we live in a society where, you know, we're expected to have the answer
right away. Yeah,
because
to tweet it out.
YouTube, yeah, tweeting. So the practice of public diplomacy, which I think, which the secretary always mentions, the president always mentions, like, you know, they take the long view, and that's why they can afford to be optimistic, is because they see the sort of long arc of the trajectory of what's happening on that front.
Absolutely, yeah. And if you go around the world, you know, people can focus on people who don't like our policies or people who say bad things in America, but you know how many people want to come study in America? How many people look at America and not even want to come here, but our values and the things we represent? I mean, we have a powerful brand in a lot of places around the world, and we should not underestimate the power to use that for good. Forget about all the other scary things we have to deal with. Think about the power to use that for good. That's pretty extraordinary, actually.
And you travel, you know, quite a bit internationally. So do you see the world sort of looks at America, so is it a way of, when you're traveling, do you get to sort of see the way that America is projected on the international stage?
You do from a specific vantage point,
okay,
right? When you travel with Secretary Kerry, it's not like being a tourist and getting to talk to a lot of sort of average people on the street. But you do. You see the power of America. You know, I was with Secretary Kerry just about a year ago when we went to Ukraine right after the uprising had happened. And we walked that square in downtown Kiev where tires were still burning, where people had literally been shot dead days before. And their pictures with candles were there. And they were looking to us to come and say, we're going to stand by you and we're going to help you get through this. This is your fight, but we're going to be there with you every step of the way. That is powerful. And that's pretty extraordinary. And when people talk about America's place in the world or American decline or the lack of American exceptionalism, they're not looking at the same world I am. Mm-hmm. And they're not meeting the same people I'm meeting. I don't know what they're looking at. But it is really extraordinary. It is.
Well, thank you. I think at this point we will take questions from you all. So, but I think that we've asked for folks to line up at
the
wonderful mics on either side of the aisle. So if you could do that, we will be happy to take your questions.
Okay.
Yeah, you have there
go ahead.
Questions. Yeah.
Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Damola Aluko. I am currently a junior political science major at Howard University. Basically, you kind of touched on how easy it is for terrorism to be spread around these days, mm-hmm. and, you know, we're currently looking on the news, and every day we hear something about ISIL or Al-Shabaab or Boko Haram. And basically, how I see it kind of is, yes, countries around the world and different states around the world, like, their goal is to deal with this kind of on the same, like, wavelength and use power in a sense, like hard power.
Yeah.
But how is the U.S. trying to lead the world in, like, soft power in terms of dealing with, like, issues of terrorism? Like, we know that the leaders of these terrorist groups are, like, elites, like, you know, wealthy people who just have these ideas, and they manipulate, you know, people who don't have much and who are suicidal and who don't have much to live for and don't have, you know, I mean, don't have education, don't have any social welfare. So what can we do to help the people of these nations mm-hmm. get opportunities so that they don't feel that they have to turn to a Boko Haram or a Islamic State to get mm-hmm. Get somewhere. So
Marie, I think what we'll do is maybe take two at a time since you're a very popular guest here.
Okay.
And we have a lot of questions. So maybe take two and answer
okay.
two. Does that make sense?
Sure.
And then you can answer that way.
Okay. Sure.
So we can take yours too.
Yeah.
Hi, Ms. Harf. My name is Colin Cavell from Bluefield State College. And we have some very eager students who do want to work for the State Department. Assistant Secretary France earlier said the State Department needs to diversify its membership to reflect more of America. And I couldn't agree more, and I'm just fantastically surprised with Ambassador Greenfield. She is truly an asset for the State Department. Mm-hmm. But my question is, what is the State Department doing you have a conference here, but are you actively recruiting to diversify the employees at the State Department, and how do you feel about it?
Mm-hmm. Well, those are both great questions. I'll start with yours and then go to yours. Absolutely, and if you look from a gender perspective, if you look at the undersecretaries of state and the assistant secretaries of state, most of them are women, which obviously isn't enough, but that's pretty extraordinary too, right? The spokespeople are women. There's a lot of, we've done a better job at promoting in the senior ranks with women, but you're right. We all need to do a better job, particularly at the sort of entry level, mid level, at diversifying our workforce in a whole variety of areas. And I know we focus on that when we're recruiting. I know when we look at applicants, we look to a diverse array of places to try and find qualified people, because the world is a huge, diverse place too. And you do best when you have folks who can represent sort of the diversity of our country, certainly in the State Department. So that's obviously a huge priority for us as well. When it comes to your question, you ask a very good question. I don't know if any of you saw, if you just Google me in Twitter or something, I've gotten a lot of heat actually over the past few weeks for some comments I and many military commanders and Republicans and Democrats have said about how you counter violent extremism. You are right. There is a role for military action. When there are terrorist groups actively killing people, threatening us, we have to take military action. We are. But in the long term, multiple experts, military commanders have said that in the long term, you cannot kill every single person that may be a terrorist, nor should you try, right? But that's not a solution. That you have to address the conditions that lead people to be susceptible to joining terrorist groups. Because you may have a radical jihadi who's posting videos online, and that's dangerous. But if you have 10,000 people willing to blow themselves up because of that message, that's much more dangerous. So how do you reach those 10,000 people? And that's a variety of factors. Some of it is ideological. Some of it is because there's a lack of governance in a country and there's no alternatives. If you look at a place like Libya right now, that's a really good example. Some of it is lack of other opportunities, lack of education, and looking at all of those factors and examining them and working with countries around the world to improve the conditions that lead people to turn to terrorism and extremism is something we're very focused on. But it's a long-term challenge, and it is not going to be fixed overnight, and military action is a key part of this, but certainly not all of it. And it's a good question, one that is very politicized right now, by the way, if you look online. But I think we all owe ourselves to do a little better and talk about it in a more nuanced way.
Absolutely. All right, so we'll take the next two.
Thank you. My name is Jelena Jevtic, and I'm an international student from Serbia and currently a freshman at Bluefield State College with a major in political science. And given that you are in press and public relations for many years, how often do you recognize news or media spin? And do you believe that maybe, for example, the disappearance of airplanes headed to Malaysia in the past year is some kind of news spin?
Okay, we'll do two and then I'll answer them.
Hi, Ms. Harf. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to come speak to us. My question has to do with Earlier you said you should say when you don't know something. But what about in the scenario where you do know something? How receptive is the leadership to suggestions and recommendations, or is it inappropriate to do so?
Well, it's always appropriate to speak up. Come on, right? No, look, I am a firm believer that, and I'm relatively young for this job, I think. I've had other jobs relatively young. But if you're respected by your colleagues and your peers and your leadership, they should want to hear your opinion. And you should speak up respectfully, smartly, at the right time. But that's why you're there. And you have a perspective on things other people don't. So in every job I've had, I've tried to figure out how to add value, whether that's from just being the first person there and the last person to leave at night, to always being the one to volunteer to do things, or to speaking up and saying, hey, I have this new idea, and not being scared if they're like, well, that's not a good idea, Marie. But don't be scared to do that. And if you're in a work environment where you are, you should maybe think about doing something else. I mean, we all can't, you know, nothing's ever perfect, I'll put it that way. But that's the best kind of place to be, I think, where people value people speaking up. And making their voice heard, and I don't know, trying to play a role here, because the more people that are trying to do things and move the ball, the better, I think, in general. We never spin in the press. What are you talking about? I'm one of those press people that I have a point of view, and I have a narrative, and I have a goal. But as a press person, in order to maintain your own credibility, you tell the truth. You're sort of upfront about where you're coming from, and you can say when you disagree with something. I do think there are times when what I don't like is in the press, whether it's cable news, whether it's Twitter, whether it's blogs, when people are either sort of factually inaccurate or purposefully doing so to push an agenda. I mean, that's beyond spin. That's just sort of crap, for lack of a better term. But a lot of it's out there, and you have to push back against it. But that's this whole game we're in, right? That, like, I represent the State Department, I have certain goals. People know that. Journalists have certain goals. I know that. It just determines how you interact with them. And the planes, that's an example of the fact that conspiracy theories have the ability, in today's media landscape particularly, to take off, no pun intended, and take on a life of their own. And I mean, the number of theories out there about what happened to these planes, they just shoot around the internet, and people write blogs about them, and they all tweet at each other, and there's these listservs, and it's extraordinary, the forum it gives people to do that kind of thing, a lot of which are just conspiracy theories. Not being an expert on aviation, though. Let's take two more.
I am Egima Do again, Hampton University PhD student, business leadership and management, major in accounting and finance. I think at the moment the spread of extremism is based on ideology. But unfortunately, the United States has actually, in a way, corroborated the ideology. By this, what I mean is, what we now call ISIS has changed its name about four times, and the United States has adopted to all the names. And we know that Islamic State sounds legitimate ideologically to those poor people back there, uneducated, who are susceptible to those manipulations. Then the same thing back in Africa. Boko Haram, which means Western education is sinful, the name has still been used by the United States. So my question is, why can't the United States counter such powerful messages based on the naming strategy used by these terror organizations? The president recently said ISIS is actually not Islamic. But I don't know, how can ISIS not be Islamic when the name itself says it is Islamic, and yet we call it Islamic State?
Okay, let's take two, and then I'll answer both of them.
Hello, Ms. Harf. My name is Adrian Andres. I'm a sophomore political science major, community development minor from Howard University. My question is, you talked mainly about, you brought up the fact that you guys are having some leaders from Africa as well as Asia to, you know, develop those countries. Mm-hmm. My question is, what are you doing for the Caribbean? Because I think a lot of times we look at the Caribbean as just a vacation spot, and we forget about those surrounding areas that are still affected by poverty and unemployment. So what are the plans for that?
We actually, just a few months ago, I think, had a Caribbean-based initiative meeting here at the State Department. I think the Vice President spoke, and I know senior leaders have been very involved in this, and that's looking at issues from security, but also to economic prosperity, how education, sort of covering the range of issues in the Caribbean. I know we focused much more on it. We had this big meeting a few months ago. I'd encourage you to check that out. But you're right. I mean, this is our backyard, right? And not just security, although security is a big part of it, but education, environmental issues are certainly a big part of it. Trade, it's something we're very focused on as well. And I know that, the Vice President has done a lot of work here, and we have at this department too. When it comes to your question, you know, what we call things is an interesting one, and I'm a person who works in words, so I find it probably even more interesting. Secretary Kerry refers to ISIL, or the Islamic State. He calls it Daesh, which a lot of our Arab partners do. To deprive them of being able to use the term Islamic or state, because we believe they are neither, and not to give them religious legitimacy. So just that's one example of how it is an interesting question. And look, to speak to your first point, ideology is certainly part of what drives many people to join terrorist organizations, a warped, barbaric ideology that the president has spoken about this, the secretary has spoken about this, does not represent Islam any more than extremists acting in the name of any other religion represent them. So I think that's something certainly we've spoken out about very publicly, but in order to look at how you counter these groups across the board, you have to look at more than ideology, or else you won't be able to get to those 10,000 kids who are willing to sign up on the internet to do something for a variety of reasons, right? So, yes.
Hello, my name is Yudi Namdi. I'm a junior political science student, African studies minor from Howard University. And my question is more on the career professional aspect. Mm-hmm. You talked a lot about your trajectory and how it was very nonlinear. And my question is just, what would you consider your biggest professional gaffe or mistake? And how did you learn from it and recover, especially for many of us entering the workforce and as young adults?
That's a good question. I got to think about that one for a second. Go ahead.
My name is Tim Caberia. I work with international students at the University of the District of Columbia.
Great.
And I meant to ask Ambassador Greenfield this question, but I didn't get a chance. Now, we know study abroad is such a great tool for getting domestic U.S. students interested in the foreign service. And we also realized that a lot of students, particularly within the HBCU community, may not have the resources to spend a semester in Germany or some other place, mm-hmm. and Africa would definitely be appropriate for a lot of them. But now we have a situation whereby there are so many travel advisories given against so many mm-hmm. African countries every now and then. And then my second question is about how do you balance the separation of powers between the executive and the legislature when you find a situation where the legislature is straight up working against the executive, for instance, in the case of Netanyahu and John Boehner the other day. Thank you.
There's three great questions there. So on the study abroad question, I'll start there. Actually, my father, who's now retired from Ohio State, what he does now in retirement is take students on study abroad programs. And he's done it for a couple universities, the University of Tampa and Maryville University, that traditionally didn't have huge study abroad programs. So kids who some of them had never been out of Florida or Missouri, and he helps them get passports and takes them around the world. And I think that's pretty extraordinary. I've seen some of these letters students write him, and I've gotten to go on one of these trips with him. And showing people the rest of the world when they never have done that is a really amazing thing to get to do. So certainly are very supportive of study abroad programs, the lessons they can teach you. We have State Department internships around the world too, which is another way to sort of live and work overseas before you enter the workforce. But they're not required. And I think sometimes people think, you know, they're a great thing to do, but there are lots of other ways that you can get that kind of experience at different points in your career. But certainly encouraging study abroad programs, particularly among schools that haven't had a big tradition of it, You know, that's who you really want to reach. And that's what gets people interested in the rest of the world. And I've seen that sort of firsthand through what my dad's done. But it's invaluable. And so the more of it we can do, the better. The legislature, the Congress. The great thing about this country is we have a robust political system where we can debate and disagree. And we do that all peacefully. And it's pretty amazing when you think about some of parts of the rest of the world. But that's the way elections go. Sometimes Congress is the same party, sometimes it's not. Sometimes, you know, that's the way this goes. But one, I think, premise that is better in principle and isn't always in practice, but we believe in, is that politics stops at the water's edge. And by that, I mean foreign policy should be nonpartisan. Now, it obviously is a lot, right? But America's strongest when we speak with one voice overseas, regardless of the politics back home. So when things happen that sort of undermine that, I think just as a general matter, we don't like that. So that's a good premise that we work towards. Overseas, you know, when despite the political squabbling at home, we're best when we're united. And so that's what we try to achieve, sometimes more successfully than others. My biggest professional gaffe or mistake, oh God. That's a good question. I will say, what I was referencing in response to two questions ago, I did a cable interview on Hardball with Chris Matthews a few weeks ago where I said something that to me was totally uncontroversial. I'd heard the president say it, I'd heard military I mean, sometimes when I leave an interview, I know if I've gone a little too far. I left this interview, I went to dinner with my dad, he was in town, thought nothing of it, and it exploded. It exploded on Twitter. Do not look on Twitter, it's not good. You should not look at it. It exploded on cable news. And in the span of a week, people were going back and getting my college thesis and posting it online. They were crazy, right? All because of one sentence I said that I thought, and I actually still think, was not in any way controversial. So I wouldn't say that I made a mistake there, but it's instructive. That in today's media climate, anything you can say can set off a fire. I mean, I had people tweeting the meanest things you can imagine. And it's not based on what I said, most of it. It's often based on how I look or how old I am or that I'm a woman, which makes it even worse. People were calling my parents at home. I mean, this is crazy, right? But it was very instructive to me that in this job, that is a danger. And I wouldn't change it for anything, but it makes you, you know, be very careful when you say things, you know?
But then, Marie, it also goes back to the question about, you know, news versus spit. It's like what you can, you know, I think that with your job, it's your job is to get out there and give them the facts and the truth as we see it. But beyond that, you can't control whether they're going to take anything that you say and just take that one soundbite and take it out of context literally and then run with it. But I think that you know, you're in a position every day where you are susceptible to what you might say, big professional gas, but really what it comes down to is like is how you actually end up rebounding after that because again, you can't control what they take out of context too.
And I was shocked by this. I had never witnessed something like that. And maybe I shouldn't be, maybe I'm too Pollyanna, but it was just, it was extraordinary. Yeah. And it was endless. And, you know, it's just interesting.
But it was instructive about the way that the media works. And even you and your position, how long you've been doing this, it's just another sort of example of, oh, here it goes. Yeah, exactly.
Yes, yes. And you can't let it scare you. The reason people attack people in this way is to get you to stop talking. It goes to your question. No. It's my job. But B, you cannot let people who act like that make you change what you're doing if you believe in what you're doing, because that's what they want.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Candia Moore. I'm a sophomore advertising major at Howard. And my question is also career-based. Mm-hmm. What would you suggest communication students like me do now to prepare for positions like the one you currently hold?
Good question. Yes, let's take two and then I'll answer them. Go ahead.
I first want to thank you so much for sharing so much about your personal career path, and particularly about sort of how risky and scary it might have been to jump from something that was really safe to working for a campaign. But one of the things I also hear quite a lot is how difficult it is to actually get hired by a campaign instead of just being a volunteer.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about some of the more viable pathways that you have seen for people to actually get hired to work on a campaign.
Yeah, and that's a really great question. I mean, you can also speak to this. We can all, you know, that's a great question. And I was unique because this was my first presidential campaign. I came because I'd already been in the government. But what I would recommend, and I'm sure you have thoughts too, but, the key states when it comes to primaries. You know the key states when it comes to a general. Go to the headquarters there. If you're talking about a presidential campaign, go to the headquarters and volunteer and be the hardest working person they have. Like, if you work hard and are competent, they will give you more responsibility. Some of it is starting from the ground up. If you want to start, you know, sort of right out of college in working for a campaign and prove that you're helpful. Campaigns need helpful people, right? I mean, they need people willing to work harder than anyone else. The higher you get in your career, it's a sort of a different thing because, you know, it's political. It's not political, like with a capital P, but it's sort of, you know, people are staffing up and they're trying to figure out who's going to make moves and who's going to join. And there's some jockeying there. Some of it's luck. Some of it's who you know. DC kind of works that way sometimes. But if you want to start, you know, go to campaign headquarters and offer to do anything they will let you do, right?
Yeah, I mean, you can even go to, as she mentioned, like even some of the primary states, like you can, if you live in Virginia, for example, like they have local campaign offices there, just show up and just be ready to do anything.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Marie probably did a lot of different types of things and different jobs that she's had where she wasn't too good to do anything. It's like, be the first person there, the last person to go. And campaigns can't really exist beyond, you know, without the volunteers, really. I mean, you have your campaign structure, but really it's the volunteers that continue to do that. So I would say, in addition to going to the headquarters, but definitely try to go to your local and have them put you to work, whether it's putting things, stuffing envelopes, knocking on doors, any and everything to sort of get your feet wet in that area.
And let me tell you a little story about this. The only other campaign I've ever done besides the presidential campaign was when I was a junior in college, summer after my junior year. I was in Indiana. I was an intern on the campaign for John Fernandez, who was mayor of Bloomington and was running to be Indiana Secretary of State. That's the only other campaign I've ever done. There were two interns on the campaign. The other was a student at Duke who knew someone who was one of our fundraisers in Indiana, whose name was Reggie Love. I don't know if you all know Reggie. I know Reggie very well. We were the two interns. We were college kids driving around Indiana, stuffing envelopes, trying to get people to give money to John Fernandez to be Secretary of State. John Fernandez lost, by the way. Let's all be clear about that. I'm one for one on campaigns. But fast forward, and people he met there, people I met there, that stays with you. So that, you know, we're all in this big world together. So then he met more people, and then he ended up obviously where he was working for the president, and I'm here. So. I did not do glamorous things in that job. I can promise you that. And you got to be okay with that sometimes. Because I was good and I was excited and eager and nice to people and wanted to work hard. And you never know where you'll end up after that. You got to start somewhere. Even if it feels tiny, you got to start somewhere and you learn the basics. And then you go from there. Mm-hmm. Yes, communications. What skills? Skills? Start developing, I think, a core set of skills that help you in any job, but particularly in communications. As I said, the ability to explain, to take complicated issues and distill them and make them explainable to people is a really important one. And by that, I mean taking, you know, at the briefing every day, I have to talk about really complicated things, but being able to distill that into three bullet points and explain that calmly, rationally, answer questions. And do it quickly, that's a pretty powerful thing. And I think having, as I said, good writing skills, being a quick writer, that's also very important. But I also think part of it is an attitude, right? That you're willing to try new things and just jump into the deep end and not be scared to move to New York and apply without a job. And you should have a job, though. But, you know, move to New York and, like, try and your dream is to move there to work for an ad agency. Well, try. Keep trying. What's the worst that can happen? You want to work for the State Department, take the Foreign Service exam. If you don't pass it, take it again, or go to graduate school and get some more education, and then take it again, or figure out what else you can do that you like, and do not check boxes. And by that I mean, I think there are a lot of people who check certain boxes to get certain jobs, even if they don't like it or it doesn't interest them. Figure out what you like to do every day and what you're good at, and figure out how you can use that. And that is not the same for everyone. Like Karen said, coming to the State Department, everybody has crazy different backgrounds, even though you would think we would all have sort of similar ones. And be the hardest working person in everything you do, and the nicest. That is a Midwest thing about me. But DC is full of a lot of people who aren't all that nice. And you want to be the person that when someone says, hey, I need someone for my team, I need someone to do this, you want to be the person they think of, right? Oh yeah, she's really good. I like her. She's smart and works really hard. Let's ask if she'd be interested. That's an intangible, because you know DC has a lot of smart kids. You want the intangibles that make you stand out. I don't know. They don't always work, but sometimes they do.
So I think we're running a little short on time, but I do want to make sure we get to our remaining questions.
Yeah.
So we'll take all of them, if that's okay, Marie.
Yeah.
I'll write them, and then you can
just
go
like
through,
a press briefing.
There it is. Yeah, there it is.
I love it, but I get to sit down.
Oh,
that's better.
Yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Brandon Greer. I'm a graduate student at Morgan State University. As America is known for using propaganda, all throughout its history. Especially since the early of the 20th century, with the popularity of the radio, newspapers, TVs, and movies, and also hearing how our press is sometimes being is controlled through press, not knowing this 100% sure or not. I was curious to find out, is it hard to communicate the proper truth to the masses,
mm-hmm.
or is it that America wants to paint a picture for the world for its own agenda?
Excellent. Don't forget to introduce yourselves.
He did.
Oh, okay.
We'll do yours, and then I'll answer, and then we'll do the last two.
Thank you. My name is Siaga Duan. I'm a graduate student at the University of District of Columbia. I study water resources management. My question has to do with the issue of extremism. Last year, I recall there was an issue about arming the militants in Syria to combat a legitimate leadership that is there.
Mm-hmm.
What is the yardstick used? Or is have America identified who are those supporting, let's just say, the ISIS, mm-hmm. the ISIS, or those already behind extremism? Where does the source come from? Who are those behind them, mm-hmm. before combating this? Or are they in the process of also supporting a group to also go against a legitimate government?
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, two good quote. I forget the first. Oh, yes, propaganda. My job is to truthfully tell the American people in the world what American foreign policy is. And yes, I have an agenda. I don't use that in a negative way. I want to promote American values. I want to promote American policy. You can disagree with my policy, with our policy. It's not my policy, with our policy. But it's partly, public diplomacy is a better word than propaganda, I think. Because we want to be out there promoting the American brand and what we're doing. And that's about telling the truth. It's not about, it's the opposite of not telling the truth, right? Because the truth is really powerful, and that's how you have credibility. And, you know, we today see incredible propaganda efforts by countries like Russia that, as Secretary Kerry says, like, just lie in their press about what they're doing. And I think Secretary Kerry has said no amount of propaganda can make the words they're saying true. Because the thing about propaganda is, today, the Russians can say that they don't have any heavy weapons in eastern Ukraine, but we actually have pictures of them, and they're on Twitter. And like, that's a hard thing for propaganda to counter. They try really hard. But we think that the truth actually is the best counterpoint to that kind of propaganda at the end of the day. When it comes to Syria, which you asked about, it's exceedingly complex on the ground. ISIL. So the United States, our policy, which I think is part of what you were asking, has been to support the moderate opposition. So the opposition group that's fighting, that started off fighting the Assad regime. If you remember when this first exploded, there's this moderate opposition who's trying to unlodge the Assad regime. They are also now fighting a war against ISIL. So they're fighting a war on two fronts, which is exceedingly difficult. We're training them, we're equipping them with weapons, but this is gonna take some time. The Assad regime is also fighting them and fighting ISIL. ISIL is fighting both of them too. this is a mess, right? I mean, all you have to do is look at who's fighting who and who's taking on who. And then in the middle of that, you have all these foreign fighters who've gone to Syria, some Americans, to join ISIL, to join other, there are other terrorist groups there too, al-Nusra, some others, and they're all fighting each other. And we have said our priority in Syria is to defeat ISIL. I mean, that's where, you know, that's where a lot of their command and control is, a lot of their infrastructure. That is the United States' priority militarily. We're not fighting Assad militarily. But in the long term, I mean, we're, and some people think we should be. Some people on the Hill talked about Congress. Some people on the Hill think we should be. We are supporting the moderate opposition who is fighting Assad, but we think in the long term, there needs to be a negotiated political agreement to transition away from Assad. That's probably pretty far off at this point, because there are all these different dynamics on the ground. And this was that was hard before the rise of ISIL. The rise of ISIL, really, since last summer, has made it exceedingly difficult. It is that much more complicated on the ground. And that's, I think, one of the most concerning places today. Okay, our last two.
My name is Samuel Denna, Jr., junior at Bluefield State College. You noted that you were optimistic about the world as it is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious to know, with the foreign policy that are implemented within the world, what percentage of those are within the interests of the actors of which they are implemented against?
Can you rephrase that a little bit? I want to make sure I'm understanding your question.
I just want to know, like, the foreign policies that are implemented by the U.S., what percentage of the policies are within the interest of those who they are implemented against?
Got it. Okay. I think I've got it. And our last question.
My name is Brian Stewart. I'm a senior business administration major and a national relations minor at Morgan State University. Last year, I had the opportunity to study abroad in 12 countries through UVA with semester at sea.
I love it.
And recently went back to China through former Secretary Clinton and President Obama's 1,000 Strong Foundation, the U.S.-China Student Summit. Given the statistics for every one American student studying Mandarin, there's 300 students studying in China. Last year, Chinese students studied in America 26% up to American students studying in China 5%. Can you talk to the importance of American students studying abroad in China as it relates to U.S.-China relations, and then in broad, the importance of getting American students to study abroad so that we can remain, I guess, if you will, competitive and as it relates to our foreign policy in the future?
Yeah, and it's a great question. And I think that in a place like China, it's a perfect example. People-to-people ties are so critical. Look, we're two massive governments. We're two huge countries, two huge economies, and we work together on all those levels. But the people-to-people ties in China and other places are what drive this relationship. That those are the ties that will outlast any American administration, any Chinese premier, president that's currently in place. So those are the ties that build relationships between countries, and that is best done at that level, at average people studying, working abroad, and then going back to their countries and just expanding that network. So starting with study abroad, certainly, I think it's incredible. I mean, sort of what I said to one of the earlier questions, I think it's incredibly important. But then working at businesses, working abroad, even if you don't work for the State Department, traveling, wanting to see the world and to be everybody's a spokesperson for America overseas, right? So use that for good. That's really powerful. People you met when you were in China, may have never seen a daily press briefing, but now they know an American who represents America in a great way. That's really powerful. And I do think more students should study in China. I mean, we have an incredibly important relationship with China. Covers a vast array of issues, whether it's cyber issues, whether it's military to military, whether it's economic, whether it's human rights. There are a variety of issues we work on with China, all of which need good people learning about them and working about them and increasing ties. So I think, in general, that's a good thing. I forget the question. Oh, yes. Our foreign policy is driven by a couple of key principles. Where did you go? Oh, yes, you're up here. Good, thanks. American interests and values, whether they're security interests, whether they're promoting values like human rights or democracy, that guides our foreign policy. But that's driven by partnerships. It's not about America dictating to the world. We are very powerful. We don't need to dictate to people to prove that. So it's about partnering with countries, with communities, with groups, with leaders, with students to promote our interests, but in the interest of those communities too. And it's a balancing act, right, everywhere you go. And in some countries, there are competing interests and competing priorities. When it comes to certain countries, actually China is a really good example. Russia is actually a better example. There are these places we work together, whether it's the Iran talks, whether it's Afghanistan, but then there's something like Ukraine where we have vastly different interests. So it really is about the United States leading. We are the strongest and most powerful country in the history of the world, but you lead best by example and by partnering with people around the world who will promote those values that we, you know, are that shining city on a hill that we promote. And that's different everywhere, but it's pretty powerful still. And that's why I'm optimistic and hopeful, even though I sounded like the world was a very scary place.
No, not at all.
And we need good young people too, by the way, to keep everyone hopeful and optimistic. We
like
can't do it all.
Like young people who want to work in foreign affairs.
Exactly.
Like yourselves.
That was my point. That's my pitch to all of you.
Well, seeing as though we're a little over time, I think this is a good time to wrap up the conversation and really thank Marie.
Thank you.
Give her a round of applause for taking the time. Marie, you are one of the hardest and busiest working people in Washington, probably around the world at this point, so we understand how busy you are.
Yes.
But I think that having the opportunity to talk to people who are, even if they don't end up going into foreign affairs or any press field, but you have like sort of exhibited some of the skills and also sort of an attitude of things that they can sort of take with them with whatever career they decide on. And so just being able to spend time with the next generation of leaders, maybe somebody will be sitting in your space in
one of you better
couple
be.
Of years and will be like, I remember the time when Marie Harf talked to us and this is what she said, but this is what it's about. And so just wanted to take the time and say thank you for taking the time to do this.
Of course, it was an honor to be here. And I love hearing just the questions that are on your mind. I mean, that's what I was back in my alma mater of Indiana last weekend.
I do
2 days with students. It's just, I love hearing what's on people's minds and what they're interested in. And it's just, it was really great to be here.
Hopefully
so
they were a much maybe a nicer crowd than the crowd that you have to.
Than the reporters I just dealt with. yes, but thank you guys and have a good rest of your day and
thank you.
Safe travels.
All right. And then we'll move on to our next panel, our last one actually, which is talking about careers. And if people have not talked to Marty, just make sure that you're talking to folks also who are outside who can explain a little bit more about the Department of State per se. So
cool. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.